Christian Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Sharing Love Abundantly in Special Needs Families, The Five Love Languages for Parents Raising Children with Disabilities, by Gary Chapman and Jolene Philo. Narrated by Jolene Philo and Kailen Fleck. Dedication. From Gary. To Bob and Joan Long in memory of Randy. From Jolene, to Hiram, Alan, and Anne. Foreword. On the morning of July 28, 1997, I waddled into the labor and delivery hospital room. Having delivered two children, I knew that natural childbirth is a wonderful option for many women, but I am not one of them. After 3 hours of very few contractions, the doctor ordered an epidural. Within 5 minutes, my contractions hit with the speed of a crazy flying-off-the-rails freight train. Nurses raced in and called the doctor, who arrived just in time to catch Jonathan as he burst into the world. So much for knowing what to expect when you're expecting. Only days into Jonathan's life, not knowing what to expect became a theme for our lives. By age 3, he had been hospitalized more times than I could count. He was diagnosed with an immune system disorder, asthma, allergies, autism, and intellectual developmental disability. Days were filled with cleaning up vomit, breathing treatments, doctor's appointments while caring for John's two older siblings. It was like trying to juggle Jell-O. For years, I tried to fix John. Therapies, diets, research, and hours spent with specialists and school teachers helped me learn about his needs, but no one could fix my son with disabilities. I learned to communicate with him using some sign language, to hold him as he cried, to rub his feet, which seemed to calm him from crying. By age 9, John was diagnosed with a myriad of conditions, including a seizure disorder, severe Tourette's, and an anxiety disorder. He had been so badly bullied and assaulted, he acquired a traumatic brain injury and severe post-traumatic stress disorder. I was now a single parent raising 3 children. Everything I had expected as a parent had faded or fallen apart. In the process, my faith was fractured, forcing me to examine what I believed about God, life, and love. Over 2,000 years ago, a baby came into this world in the most unexpected way, born to an impoverished, unwed mother. There was no hospital, doctor, or delivery room, only a foul-smelling, barn-like stable where they spent their first days together. As the child grew, he did the unexpected. He was different. He hung out with weirdos and rejects. He chose friends that most considered sinful and rebellious. In addition, he talked about things like loving others unconditionally and taking time for the weak. He touched those with diseases. He spent quality time with those society disregarded. He affirmed and accepted everyone without expectation of recognition. He talked about loving others, though his love was something most people could not understand. The night before he died, he washed his friend's feet. He was bullied, beaten, and betrayed. His anxiety caused him to literally sweat blood. And he showed us what abundant love looks like. Jonathan is now in his 20s. I have learned more about loving abundantly from him than from any book, sermon, or class. Love isn't learned through formal education. It's learned as we live it out. I spent years learning about my son's disabilities, but knowledge about his conditions was not the language of love. When I stopped trying to fix Jonathan, I started learning how to love him in his own language. I've learned to love my son as he needs me to love him. This is the work we are all given as people, to love others and to love them in abundance. Sharing love abundantly explains how you can love those who are different, but it does more. It describes a way of living that will change your life if you're willing to embrace its message. This book can help you abundantly love those with disabilities and special needs. It is packed with outstanding tips and practical tools, as well as real stories that reveal it's possible to love every person, including those with disabilities. Our humble Savior modeled how we are to love others. I invite you to start today and watch God change the way you and your family live and love one another. Colleen Swindall Thompson, Director, Reframing Ministries, Insight for Living.
Introduction. Over the past two decades, numerous couples have asked me to write a special edition of the Five Love Languages for Families Who Have Special Needs Children. I have been very sympathetic to their requests, but have felt inadequate to write about a topic that I have never experienced. My wife, Carolyn, and I have two healthy adult children and two healthy grandchildren. However, in my counseling office, I continue to encounter couples who are dealing with the common challenges of rearing a special needs child and maintaining a strong marriage. I have often shared the love language concept from my book, The Five Love Languages: The Secret to Love That Lasts. Many have come back to express their gratitude, but also to ask for additional help as to how the concept applies to children with special needs. I have also spoken to a number of teachers who work professionally with children who have special needs. They tell me how helpful the love language concept has been in relating to their students. Many have indicated that learning each child's love language and speaking it daily has created a different emotional climate in the classroom. They shared that the children are much more responsive when they feel loved by the teacher. But what I have discovered in my counseling with parents of special needs children is that most come to me concerned about their marriage. With all the time, energy, and effort spent in caring for a child, spouses feel themselves drifting apart. For many of these couples, learning each other's love language has been a lifesaver. In fact, many have said, "This insight really saved our marriage." They learned that whatever energy and time they had left for each other needed to be spent in expressing love in a way that was meaningful to their spouse. Understanding each other's primary love language helped them do this effectively. In this book, you will find helpful ideas on how the love languages can enhance both your relationship with each other and with your children. Jolene Philo, my co-author, and her husband Hiram have raised a son with special medical needs. She has also taught children with special needs in the classroom. She has authored 5 books and numerous articles designed to help special needs families. For the past 20 years, she has immersed herself in helping couples and extended families learn how to keep love alive while facing the challenges of raising a child with special needs. In addition to Jolene's own experience and my years of counseling couples, we draw from scores of families who have shared their journey with us for this book. Names have been changed to protect their privacy, but the stories and comments come from real-life experiences. In the first chapter, you will read Jolene and Hiram's story. In chapter 2, we will share the 7 threats to marital unity while rearing a special needs child. In chapter 3, we give examples of how the love languages can help spouses strengthen their marriages and keep those threats at bay. By the end of the 3rd chapter, we think you will want to give a copy of the book to other caregiving families. Our deepest desire is that this book will help you share love abundantly with your spouse, your child with special needs, and other children who call you Mom and Dad. Gary Chapman.
A Note to Family and Friends. On a cold February day in 2017, I received an email from a friend who is raising two children with special needs. "Jolene," she asked, "when are you going to write a book about using the five love languages in families like ours?" An inner light bulb switched on. I knew the book she had suggested, with its potential to benefit countless families, had to be written. Thanks to Dr. Chapman's concern for the well-being of families raising children with disabilities, as well as his collaboration on the project, Sharing Love Abundantly in Special Needs Families, the Five Love Languages for Parents Raising Children with Disabilities, is now a reality. Within its covers, you will meet parents caring for children with a wide range of special needs and disabilities, from cerebral palsy to attention deficit hyperactivity disorder, from Down syndrome to Ehlers-Danlos syndrome, from epilepsy to developmental delays, from autism to anxiety, from mental disorders to medically fragile conditions, from well-known diagnoses to extremely rare ones. Interacting with families as they shared their stories confirmed what I already knew. Whether your child's diagnosis is the same as my child's, or whether it's completely different, we are a unique tribe of parents raising children in extraordinary circumstances. We need simple, effective tools to enhance all of our relationships. My first hope is that Sharing Love Abundantly will be a tool for your family as you learn how to use the love languages within your unique situation. One by one, the chapters offer examples and ideas for implementing the love languages with your spouse, your children with special needs, and their siblings. A second hope follows close on the heels of the first one. I hope Sharing Love Abundantly becomes a resource for the extended family members, friends, and professionals surrounding parents raising kids with special needs. If you are one of those people, some of the chapters in this book are written for you. They show you how to use the love languages to support the families you care about and serve. They show you that while we are families engaged in extraordinary caregiving, we are ordinary people who appreciate hearing love spoken clearly. I hope this book helps you speak love to us in the ways we hear best. Jolene Philo. 1. How a Baby with Special Needs Changed the Way We Love. My husband and I were elated in the fall of 1981 when we learned I was pregnant with our first child. Hiram and I had met 7 years earlier at Westmar, a tiny Christian college in Iowa. He had been raised in Alaska by an airplane mechanic father and a schoolteacher mother. I was raised in a small northwest Iowa town by a dad diagnosed with multiple sclerosis at age 29 and a schoolteacher mom. Hiram was an athlete. I was a theater geek. He was quiet. I was not. He hated to read. I inhaled books. He was logical. I was creative. He was a romantic. I was practical. In many ways, we could have been poster children for the opposites attract school of romance. But we had more in common than was evident at first glance. We had both been raised to work hard. We both valued family and education. Most importantly, we both shared similar faith commitments. Later, Hiram said that fact, more than anything else, led him to call and ask me to be his date to homecoming. He was so nervous, his tongue tripped over his words repeatedly before he got the question out. Once I deciphered what he was saying, I said yes, without hesitation. 3 years later, in July 1977, We got married. A year after that, we graduated and moved to Camp Crook, a town of 92 people in the very northwest corner of South Dakota. We had accepted jobs, Hiram as a caseworker, and me as a teacher at Sky Ranch for Boys, a facility for troubled youth. After 2 years at the ranch, I accepted a job at the public school in Camp Crook. Many of the town's activities revolved around the school. Therefore, when we announced our first child was on the way, the baby's impending arrival was a community affair. My husband and I, as well as my students and their families, waited eagerly for baby Philo's appearance in late May. I went into labor one Saturday evening, and Alan Craig Philo was born shortly after midnight on May 23, 1982, at the hospital in Spearfish, South Dakota. We called our parents immediately with the good news, but waited until morning to phone our friends in Camp Crook. By morning, the news wasn't all good. Our baby's breathing had become increasingly labored during the night, and the doctor ordered an X-ray. When the results proved inconclusive, he asked to transfer our son to Rapid City Regional Hospital for more tests. Stunned, Hiram and I gave our consent. There wasn't even time to see our baby and kiss him goodbye. A little before noon, a pediatrician from Rapid City called with a diagnosis. Hiram was showering at a friend's house when the doctor explained what the tests had revealed. Your son has a tracheal-esophageal fistula. That means his esophagus comes down from the throat and forms a blind pouch. It comes up from his stomach and hooks into his trachea. He needs immediate surgery to save his life. The doctor cleared his throat. The good news is that the success rate for this surgery is 92%, the highest for any major birth anomaly. The bad news is that the closest hospitals equipped to do this surgery are the University of Nebraska in Omaha or the University of Colorado in Denver. The doctor paused. Where do you want him sent? He asked. My heart was breaking. My hormones were raging, and I desperately wanted to talk to my husband before deciding, but the doctor said there was no time to waste. Omaha, I whispered, knowing it was only a few hours from where my parents lived. Take him to Omaha. With those words, my heart cracked in two. On that day, we began our lives as parents of a child with special needs. From his birth until shortly after his fourth birthday, Alan endured 7 corrective surgeries, dozens of invasive medical tests and procedures, and innumerable doctor's appointments. He had a final surgery at age 15. As a young adult, he was treated for post-traumatic stress disorder, PTSD, caused by the early invasive surgeries and procedures that had saved his life. He's an adult now, a husband, a dad, and a valued employee. Raising a child with special needs changed the dynamics of our family, touching all of us in significant ways. The experience defined the way we parented our son. It strained and changed our marriage. It altered our relationship with our daughter, Anne, who is 6 years younger than Alan. And it impacted our daughter's relationship with her older brother. In many ways, we are who we are because of our son's special needs. Discovering the 5 love languages. We were changed by our parenting experience, but once our son's health stabilized, our lives became more predictable. We once again became active in our church, and we were excited when it offered a Sunday school class based on a brand new book by Gary Chapman called The 5 Love Languages. Communication between Hiram and me had been a struggle since the beginning of our marriage. 4 years of emergency surgeries and sleepless nights with a very sick child had only exacerbated the problem. We signed up for the class and read the book eagerly. In it, Gary described how difficult it would be for someone from China who didn't know a word of English to communicate with you or me, or vice versa. Even if you drew pictures, used gestures, and paid attention to facial expressions, effective communication would be almost impossible. He used the metaphor of literal language to help readers understand the different ways individuals perceive emotional love. The perceptions are so distinct, they comprise 5 different languages or channels of communication. We all have at least one language that communicates emotional love to us more than the others. Understanding each other's love language and choosing to speak it greatly enhances our relationships.
A quick guide to the 5 love languages. I, Gary, never tire of hearing how the love languages enhance a marriage. Let me give a brief summary of the 5 love languages. Words of affirmation. Unsolicited compliments, whether verbal or written, or words of appreciation. Examples. I love you. You did an amazing job. You look great in that dress. I really appreciate your attention to details. Dialects include words of encouragement, humble words, and words of kindness. Saying nice things about a person to others counts too, because the message often travels back to him or her as others repeat the compliment. A words of affirmation person can be emotionally devastated by insults and harsh words. Quality time. Giving someone your full, undivided attention. Dialects are quality conversation, sharing thoughts, feelings, desires, and experiences with the emphasis on really listening to another person, and quality activities, sharing memory-making experiences. A quality time person can be hurt by half-hearted or distracted listening or by repeatedly postponing promised time together. Gifts, or receiving gifts. Any purchased, handmade, or found tangible gift to let someone know you care. A gift is a visible symbol of love. Price is irrelevant. Meaningful gifts can range from costly to having no monetary value at all. It is the thoughtfulness and effort behind a gift that send the "I love you" message. Being physically present, the gift of your time, is an intangible gift that is very precious to some people, especially in times of crisis, illness, or celebration. A gifts person can be hurt by a forgotten anniversary or birthday, or left feeling empty in a relationship void of tangible tokens of love. Acts of service, doing helpful things for another person, such as setting the table, walking the dog, washing dishes, vacuuming, or grocery shopping. The purpose of acts of service is to lighten the load of the other person. Acts of service require thought, planning, time, and effort. The idea is not simply to stay busy or to do the tasks you enjoy most, but to do the things that are most meaningful and helpful to the other person. An acts of service person can be hurt by laziness, someone leaving a mess for them to clean up, or a forgotten promise to help. Physical touch. Deliberate touch that requires your full attention to deliver, such as a back rub, a foot massage, a hug, a high five, or a kiss. Incidental touch that requires little or no extra investment of time, such as sitting close to a person on the sofa or touching their shoulder as you walk by. For a physical touch person, touch sends the clearest "I love you" message. For a physical touch person, a slap or any kind of abuse or neglect can cause extreme emotional pain.
Each of us has a primary love language. One of the 5 speaks more deeply to us than the other 4. Husbands and wives, parents and children, and even good friends usually don't speak the same love language. The language that comes naturally to each of us and makes us feel loved is the one we use instead of speaking in the other person's language, the one that makes them feel loved. Even when both people speak their love language loudly and often, if they aren't speaking in the other person's language, neither one will feel loved. Some people also have a secondary love language that speaks loudly to them. Heavy doses of the primary and secondary love languages will keep the emotional love tank full. Once people know about the five love languages, and discover the primary languages of the significant people in their lives, the next step is to make a concerted effort to speak to each person in that person's love language. When couples, and indeed whole families, mutually embrace the concept and communicate love the way that's most meaningful to the other person, both people feel emotionally loved. Intentional love, spoken consistently, fluently, and in the right language, deepens a relationship and equips it to weather the storms of life that will inevitably come. Gary's description of the five love languages and how to employ them resonated with Hiram and me. We took the quiz in the book to discover our own love languages. Our communication struggles lessened after I learned to speak his physical touch and quality time, and he learned to speak mine, acts of service and words of affirmation. As Gary explained, speaking in each other's love language was a way to fill the other person's love tank. Keeping love tanks full. My experiences as a mom and my training as an elementary teacher made me suspect that the love languages could deepen our relationships with our children. We intentionally tried all five love languages with our kids and observed how they responded. When we began speaking their languages, family life got a whole lot easier and way more fun because everyone's love tank was being filled. Child psychologists affirm that children have certain basic emotional needs that must be met if they are to be emotionally stable. One of these basic needs is for love and affection, which creates a sense of belonging and being wanted. Every time Hiram and I spoke to our kids in their love languages, we were filling their little love tanks. Since full love tanks mean less isolation between spouses and improved behavior in kids, it was no wonder life got easier and more fun the more we used the love languages at home. I wish the five love languages had been available when Alan was born and during the years when our lives were a chaotic mix of health concerns for our baby and unending surgeries. If we'd known about the love languages then, Hiram and I could have spoken them to one another during the long drives to our son's medical procedures and doctor's appointments. We could have lavished all five languages on our little boy until we figured out his preferred ones, so he could enter the doctor's office or hospital with his little love tank full, and so we could replenish it as he recovered from surgeries or tests. But instead of brooding about what I couldn't change, I looked for ways to use the love languages to create healthier relationships in our family circle and beyond. I started to use the languages with students at school. Resources hadn't yet been created for determining kids' primary languages, so I injected all five whenever feasible during the school day. All my students responded, perhaps because they heard me talking their language, or perhaps because my intentional efforts created a more positive classroom climate. The students who benefited most were those with special learning needs, children whose primary love language was probably not the one used most frequently by teachers, words of affirmation. When these students heard their love language spoken in our classroom through a pat on the shoulder, physical touch, me sitting down and listening to them read, quality time, lending a hand with the pesky classroom pencil sharpener, acts of service, or receiving gifts, a sticker or pencil, our classroom became a place where they felt like they belonged. Determining everyone's love language. These experiences proved, at least to me, that the five love languages are a powerful tool to use with children. After Gary wrote books about using the love languages with children and teens, parents were better equipped to use them with typically developing kids of any age. But until now, there has been no resource devoted to the unique challenge of using the love languages with kids who have special needs. We, Gary and Jolene, wrote this book to equip every member of special needs families, parents, typical siblings, and children with special needs, to do two things: discover their love languages and to use the languages effectively with one another. Gary's love language quiz for couples and single parents is located at the end of this chapter. His love languages mystery game for younger children and a quiz for teens, both of which can be used with typical siblings, are also found there. Strategies parents can use to determine the love languages of their children who are babies and toddlers, nonverbal, developmentally delayed, or medically fragile are explained in Chapter 5. You can take the quiz now or wait until you finish the entire book. In future chapters.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.